So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Amrit Sarkar, working as search engineer at Lucidworks. And for next half an hour or so, we will see how we can build analytics applications with streaming expressions in Apache Solr. A bit about Lucidworks. We are a search enterprise company based out of San Francisco. We have offices all over the world, including Bangalore. We have a product, Lucidworks Fusion, which is built on top of Apache Solr, which drives search engines. And also, we provide consulting and support organizations who are using Solr as their search or analytics technology. So we will begin the discussion with the challenges one faces while building this application on near real-time data. We will introduce streaming expression and get a brief overview of the same. We will categorize our expressions to sources, decorators, and evaluators, and we will see some certain examples. This particular talk is heavy use case based. We will discuss some real life use cases from some simple to complex one and understand their performance complexity. We will then introduce statistical programming. These are some fairly new statistical functions being added in Solr before listing out the references. So building an analytics application on offline data, we have a number of tools and technologies already available. You can pre-process your offline data to create certain views, which can further become an input for creating your meaningful dashboards. The challenge arises when you receive constant updates and you need to refresh your analytics applications at regular intervals. Executing complex correlations and functions on unstructured, non-pre-processed data is extremely time-consuming. Also, to bring together an entire analytics application, you're dependent on multiple tools. A database, a tool for pre-processing the data, a data visualizer to build the dashboards, which leads to higher maintenance cost. So before listing out what is streaming expression, let's get a brief overview of what Apache Solr is. Apache Solr is an open source search engine built on top of Apache Lucene library. It's highly scalable, flexible, and provides rich search capabilities on text. There is a distributed mode in Solr called Solrcloud, where your number of Solr nodes can reside on different servers, which is being managed by Apache Zookeeper. There are other features like spelling, auto-completion, highlighting available in Solr itself. In this talk, we'll discuss about streaming and aggregations. And we have advanced features like learning to rank, which leverages machine learning algorithms to better your search experience. So the features on the right-hand side comprise the parallel computing framework of Apache Solr, which is only available in the Solrcloud mode. In this talk, we will discuss streaming API, expression shuffling, and worker collections, while parallel SQL is a wrapper on top of streaming expression. Whatever SQL query you provide to Solr gets converted into a streaming expression internally and gets executed implicitly. Starting with streaming API, it's a Java API available for parallel computation of MapReduce and relational algebraic operations. You create streaming objects through Stream Factory, and you have a number of APIs available to perform different operations. The open function emits the search results as stream of tuples. Each tuple is a tuple stream object. Tuple stream is the base class of streaming in Apache Solr source code. And all the relatable streaming objects APIs are available in the package org apache solr client solrj.io. To extend these capabilities of streaming to non-Java folks who are building their applications on Ruby, Python, Perl, or any other programming language or script, streaming expressions were introduced. These are string query language and the serialized format for the streaming API. This expression can compile to a tuple stream object, and tuple stream object can then further be serialized to streaming expression. They can be executed directly via HTTP to a Solrj, which can further be executed against an API stream, which is implicitly defined in Solr itself. Now let's look at a common example. Here we are performing a full index search on a Solr collection and retrieving some specific fields only. If you look at the bottom, we are executing this query against the stream API, and the expression itself is a search expression, which is taking the input getting started, which is the collection name. We have specified the zookeeper on which this collection is hosted, localhost 9883. In the queue parameter, we have hashbacks. We only want to retrieve those documents which has the keyword hashbacks in any of their fields. And we are limiting the result set to year 2014. We are retrieving ID and model name, and we want the final result set to be in the ascending order of ID. Looking at the result on the right side, on the right top corner, we can see the representation of what is happening. That is, we are fetching data from the collection, getting started, and performing a search on top of it. The result set is emitted in the form of a JSON, where we have ID 1, 2, 3 in the ascending order with respect to their model names, M and O. The last tuple of streaming expression is EOF endofile true with its response time, where response time is the execution time of the expression in the Solr servers itself. In this example, it's 12 milliseconds. This expression can then further be divided into certain categories depending upon their usability. We have stream sources, which are the origin of tuple stream. That is, you have search and facet stream, which can fetch data from a Solrcloud collection. You have JDBC, which can pull data from a relational database. And you have stats, topics, time series train, which can pull data from a machine learning model, which can extract certain features. These sources are then wrapped around by stream decorators, which performs the aggregations, operations, and functions on top of them. These operations are performed row-wise. So let us suppose you want to merge two result set, perform an inner join, select only top five, or only want to select unique tuples or unique rows. Stream decorators are there. Now, if you want to calculate or add new field values, depending on the existing field value on each row, stream evaluators comes into action, and they are operated column-wise. You can execute straightforward mathematical calculations like division, multiplication, summation, and also can perform conditional statements like if, else, then. So as I said in the beginning of the talk, we will discuss some real life use cases here. All the use cases discussed has been adopted by our clients at Lucidworks in one way or other. So first look at the data set we have here. So let us suppose we have a collection where we have data of certain flights of their source city and their destination city. And we want to determine the destinations which are reachable within single stop from New York. That is, they have a stoppage or a layover kind of a thing. There is obviously a number of solutions which are possible of achieving this particular use case. But we can, in this particular example, we'll try to visualize this data in a graphical format. So the inner nodes streaming expression on the distances collection will put the New York as the root node of that graph. And it will gather all the immediate destination cities from New York. This inner destinations we are gathering here will become then the input for the sources for the outer nodes streaming expression, such that we will get one level away from New York all the destination cities. Looking at the graphical representation, right? And if you look at the result set, New York is at level 0 because it is the root node. And we have another node, Bengaluru, which is at level 2 as desired, whose ancestors are Paris and New Delhi, such that you can fly from New York to New Delhi to Bengaluru, or you can fly from New York to Paris to Bengaluru. Then there is a very popular use case where you have a big amount of data in your in a collection or basically in Cassandra, anywhere in a storage device, and you want to retrieve some relevant keywords from that so that you can get a brief summary of what that data represents. Significant expression in Solr leverages Apache Lucene's rich text search capabilities and helps us to retrieve those terms. I'm using the dataset enroll emails here, which is a very popular training set for a data science problem. And we are restricting the result set to Q Tim Belden. That is, all the emails sent to Tim Belden only. Some extra parameters like the minimum documents those terms should be present are 10. Not more than 20% of the documents should contain that keyword so that you can rule out the very common English words you use in a communication, helping verbs, articles, prepositions, etc. And we are also defining the minimum length of this term should be 5. Looking at the result, we will get this information in the descending order of scores depending on their relevance. So we have the term entities and the term John Gillaria, which were used more number of times when anyone was sending an email to Tim Belden. Now, these were very straightforward use cases we discussed where we just leveraged one single streaming expression and got our result. Let's try a bit more complex one. So we have two data sets here on the right-hand side. We have the data of certain organizations who have adopted certain campaigns, and we have weekly data of their impressions, clicks, and conversions. Looking at the data, we have campaign O1, organizations O1, received 134 impressions, 48 clicks, 4 conversions, and we have this information in weekly manner. On the left-hand side, we have the currency or the cost a company or an organization incurred while adopting these campaigns. That is, for campaign O1, it cost 6,600 units. And we want to calculate real-time analytics, some real-time useful metrics on top of them. So we want to calculate conversion ratio, CTR, click-through rate, or some cost ratio, convergence to currency cost. So first, we need to visualize this entire 2 data set at one place so that we can do those mathematical calculations. We have to join the cost data with aggregated conversions, clicks, and impressions per campaign. And for the simplicity of this talk, we will be just restricting the data set to organizations O1. So first, we will execute a search stream expression. We already saw an example of the same. We are restricting that result set to organizations O1. We are wrapping this search expression with a rollup. Rollup performs a straightforward group by or rolling up over a field. We have specified the field as campaign ID. And along with rolling up over, we are calculating some extra variables like the summation of conversions, impressions, and clicks to get the aggregated data. Once we have this aggregated data, we will wrap around our rollup expression with a select, which will just rename these variables to whatever name we want to give. In this example, we have some parenthesis conversions as AGGRCONV, and respectively, we can rename it for impressions and clicks. Then finally, we will fetch data through search expression from currency cost collection, and we will join the result set of this search expression with the top level select. We will inner join it on the field campaign ID. Now, this looks like a big query, right? Let's look at the representation to understand what's happening here. If you look at the graphical representation on the top right corner, you're fetching data from weekly data, performing a search on top of it, rolling up over a field campaign ID, renaming the variables to select. Parallelly, you are fetching data from a currency cost collection, performing a search on top of it, and these results set are inner joined. In the result set, we have for campaign ID campaign 01, the respective conversions are 41, currency cost 6,600, clicks 259, and we have these numbers for campaign 02 and campaign 03 as well. Now, since we have the entire data at one particular place, we can visualize data at one single frame. We need to just now calculate some mathematical calculations. So we will wrap around our entire query we discussed in the last slide with the select and perform divisions. So to get our conversion ratio, we will divide our aggregated conversions to clicks. To get our CTR, click-through rate, we'll divide our aggregated clicks to impressions. Similarly, for cost ratio, we will divide our currency cost to aggregated conversions. So we'll look at the graphical representation from left to right. We will understand how we are forming this query from the beginning, how we have reached so far. Looking at the numbers, I hope it is visible. Otherwise, I'll just summarize. For campaign 03, CTR is 0.36, which is the best in case of these three. And the other two ratios, conversion ratio and the cost ratio, is the best for campaign 01 as compared to the other two. So we are done with discussing streaming expression with one phase where we discuss the use cases we can implement. Let's move on to discuss how complex they are when they get into execution. So whatever we discussed in the last slide, we calculated some metrics. Now we want to store this metrics in a separate collection as part of a report. It can be monthly, biannual, annual, or a weekly thing too. So you have an update expression. We will wrap over the entire expression we just created in the last slide. And we will specify the collection we want to index, which is, in this case, the collection name is report. Now I have specified the batch size to be 500. We have only 3 rows there for campaign 01, 02, 03. This batch size 500 is just for significance that if you have a result set with millions and millions of docs, it will index those documents in the batch size of 500 only. Looking at the representation from left to right, we are now up until the update expression. And if you look at the result set, we are indexing 3 documents as we calculated, and we have something called worker here. All the use cases discussed until now are being executed by single node or single worker only. There is no parallelism being introduced until now, right? And assuming there are n number of rows being involved for executing this expression. Our performance complexity is big O notation of n. Now, there is a concept called shuffling in streaming expression. Now, as I just said, we in the use cases we discussed until now, only single node was used while executing this expression. So the request will be sent from a client to a stream handler, which will forward these updates to the respective workers. We can define more than one workers for a streaming expression execution. Now, I hope everyone understands what the Solr collection is. It represents the entire data set. This entire collection can then further be divided into logical slices called shards, and each shards can have multiple copies called replicas. In this case, we have 5 shards, 1 to 5, and 2 replicas each, such that we have total 10 cores, which is representing the Solr collection. Now, these workers which has received this respective streaming expression query will then fetch data randomly from this cores, such that worker 1 can fetch data from shard 2 replica 2, worker 3 can fetch data from shard 1 replica 1, and worker 5 can fetch from shard 3 replica 2, and respectively the other workers. And every time you execute the same query, they can fetch data from a different shard, from a different core. Now, we can have a use case where we want to send the correlated subset to a single worker only. Suppose you have a data set, you have a field category. You want to send all the documents with category signs to one of the workers, say worker 1. You want to send all the documents with category mathematics to other workers, say worker 2, and correspondingly for other workers, such that you have correlated data at one space, and when you perform those mathematical calculations, the numbers are calculated right. So this particular concept been called as control shuffling, and where we can specify that particular parameter that send a particular subset to a particular worker, such that each worker will request each shard in a collection and only retrieve those particular documents. Now, these workers we discussed are basically part of a worker collection. These worker collections are just a regular Solr collection in a Solrcloud cluster. They can be part of the same cluster, or they can be part of an entirely mutually independent cluster. And the goal here is to separate out data processing from data fetching. You can have a primary collection which is hosting your primary data, and you can have another worker collection residing somewhere else which will fetch the data from your primary collection and perform the processing, so that you can have multiple servers doing multiple things. So as I said, worker collections perform streaming aggregations, and they will receive shuffled stream from the replicas. And they can be empty, they can be created just in time, or they can be a regular Solr collection which are hosting their own data of its own. So I hope everyone is still with me on the use case we discussed 2 slides before. We calculated some metrics and indexed to a separate collection. Now we want to implement the same use case, this time parallelly using n number of workers. Now, this is a big query. We discussed until now the update. Until the update, we formed that query, which will be wrapped around by a parallel whose first parameter is the worker collection name, in this case, worker itself. And we have defined the number of workers we want to leverage, which is 3. This worker collection is being hosted on the same zookeeper the primary collections are, and I want the final result set to be sorted in the ascending order of campaign. Now, I discussed something about control shuffling. So, for calculating the numbers in this use case, we want to send all the documents of campaign O1 to one of the workers, O2 to the other worker, O3 to the any other available workers. So we have a parameter called partition keys, which you can define in the stream sources. In this case, we have 2 stream sources, a search which is fetching data from weekly data, another search which is fetching data from currency cost, and you specify the partition keys as the field name you want to partition the data on, which is campaign ID. Let's look at the result. So now, on the left-hand side, we have the representation where we can see 3 parallel execution of that update expression getting accumulated or aggregated on a parallel node. And on the right-hand side, we have the result set. Worker shard to replica N4 is responsible for only indexing 1 document. There is another shard replica which is responsible for the other one. And finally, shard 4 replica N12 is indexing the last document. Now, if we calculate the complexity of this expression, obviously some extra amount of work needs to be done to aggregate these respective results from each worker, which we denote them as Z3. While we assume that there are a total n number of rows being involved for executing this expression, which now will become big O notation of n divided by W, where W represents the number of workers we are using here. Since the first parameter is almost negligible as comparison to the other in terms of complexity, we can safely ignore it, and we can state that the execution time of this streaming expression has been improved by the number of workers we are using. So now we discuss about statistical programming in Solr, which these are some really new statistical functions being added into streaming expressions. So now Solr rich search text capabilities can be combined with in-depth statistical analysis. You can now do covariances, correlations, Euclidean distance, k-nearest neighbor graphs. You can represent your graph in multiple formats through statistical programming, which are backed by Apache Commons math library. This statistical programming syntax are used to create arrays from list of tuples so that you can transform, manipulate, or analyze. Let's discuss a use case of actually how we can use this. So these are some real stock market data from February 2013 to January 17, and I have abstracted their names. So for stock price for company A on 1st February 2013, the closing points were 30. As a stock B on the same date was 168, and correspondingly we have this information for stock C. And we have this historical data for 4 years. And we want to determine here the correlation among the stocks from the historical data. For a given time frame, if the stock prices for company A is going up, at the same time the stock prices for company B is going up, then they are positively correlated. While if the opposite is happening, that is the stock prices for company B is going down, they are negatively correlated. So let's determine the correlation among the stocks A to B first. So there is a let expression which allows us to set variables within an expression itself, and it outputs a single tuple. Then we will implement two different search expressions here. The first expression will fetch data from the historical stocks data collection and will restrict the result set to stock A and assign it to the variable name of its own name, stock A. The second search expression will limit the data to stock B and assign it to the variable of the same name, stock B. This stock A and stock B will then become input for a statistical function called COL. This will take COL stock A closing points. It will take all the closing points from stock A result set, put into one single array, and assign it to the variable prices A. Similarly, it will pull all the closing points from stock B and assign it to another variable called prices B. And at the last, this prices A and prices B will become input variables for another statistical function called COR, which will implement Pearson product moment correlation. Now, Pearson product moment plots an XY graph of two variables and analyze how parallel they are to each other. The more parallel they are, the value will be more closer to 1, otherwise minus 1. Now, let's see the result. So, the stock A to stock B correlation is 0.999 and so on. So, suppose a new CEO is going to be appointed for company A, or a new brand ambassador is going to be announced, and you anticipate a rise in the stock prices for company A, you can make a very bold prediction that the stock prices for company B will also go up. While the correlation between A to C is minus 0.18 and so on, which is moderately negative. The trend of the stock prices of company A has nothing to do with the trend of the stock prices of company C. So the final takeaway from this talk is streaming expression in Apache Solr allows us to perform complex correlations on MapReduce and statistical functions, which can be executed parallelly using n number of workers, on dynamic subsets, which leverages Apache Solr's rich text search capabilities. With these subsets can be fetched from various data sources, Solr collection, databases, etc. And this entire expression can be executed in near real time, making the analytics application in near real time possible. So these are the references and the knowledge base article listed for this particular talk. All the use cases and example are uploaded on the GitHub handle Sarkar Amrit to Stream Solr. Check out the official documentation of streaming expression and statistical programming. This talk is heavily influenced by Mr. Joel Bernstein's blog, who is the creator of streaming expression in Apache Solr. And I've also listed out some presentation links from last 4 years of relevant to this topic. That's it from me. Thank you so much for being here. And I think I have a decent amount of time left to answer some questions.
Thank you, Amrit. Who has questions? One, anybody else? Two, yeah, you can start.
Yeah. Hi, Amrit, it is a fine talk here. Hello, hello, Amrit.
Hi, sir.
It's a fine talk. Now I want to ask you, suppose we are working in a real-time situation where real-time data is coming from some monitoring part.
Yes.
Through Kafka.
Yes.
And we are just getting the information and putting it on the dashboard.
Yes.
And that time, how Apache Solr works. Suppose for some part of the day, we want some streaming expression on a particular interval of data.
Yeah.
So how Apache Solr fits in this scenario?
Yes. So you have an option of specifying time series data. You can restrict your time frame if you have a field called time, which is in a data field type. You can specify your entire time frame from this time to this time. It will be a start, there will be an end. And because of Solr rich search capabilities, it will fetch those particular documents from the given time frame very quickly, fairly quickly. And then these expressions will work on top of it.
Hello. So you mentioned that you mentioned that this can fetch data in near real time.
Yes.
So let's say I have to join two data sets. If the data sets are pretty big, it is still going to take time. So for example, if I run a Hive query, it will still take time because data sets are big. Yeah. So what's the difference between, let's say, running a query on Hive and running a query on Solr?
Yeah. So first of all, in the challenges part, I state that when you want to have a dynamic subset, right, you want to fetch a dynamic subset from one data set, your big data set you have, and another dynamic subset from a second data set. First of all, Solr's capabilities helps us to retrieve those documents. Second, depending on the number of workers you're using, right, you can always, this performance of streaming expression execution is linear to the number of workers you're using. So I'm not going to go into very much details about like the physical cores for servers and all. But for 25 million documents, you can execute these joins and perform this analytics in less than a second. Those are the benchmarks we've done. Now, depending on how Hive is comparison to the Solr, obviously Hive has their own advantages. Solr has its own. But here you have the liberty to expand your Solr cluster as many nodes as possible, and which will linearly will improve your performance. Yeah.
Amrit, I have a question. So it's kind of a very obvious question because so when you see Solr, the other tools that come to mind is Elasticsearch and let's say the others. So I have worked with Elasticsearch quite 2-3 years back. So it has quite changed from that point of time. So when you and both are very comparable. Like I was doing a Google search and people don't have any opinion which one to choose. So what do you think, like in all these use cases that you described are, I think, possible in Elasticsearch also.
Yes.
So which one to pick, like any performance and differences or some other feature differences which are present?
Right. So yes, we can do all that, I think, in Elasticsearch. While I will restrict that, there are 70 plus statistical functions already available in the Solr. I'm not that confident whether they are available in the Elasticsearch as of now. Also, see, both are open source search engines, but the community development, how big a community has been built around a particular project is also very helpful of solving certain problems, right? As being of comparison, Elasticsearch is, yes, more seen as an analytics tool. Solr is being more seen as a search tool to build search engines. While the inclusion of streaming expressions in Solr, now, effective analytics application is also possible in Solr on top of the search which already it provides. So there is a BOF session on Solr itself. And this is a very broad topic you bought because we have to now compare feature to feature, what's possible, what's not possible. So, yeah.
Okay, just one quick question. Sure. So there is a ALK stack has Kibana, right? So is there something equivalent to Kibana in the Solr?
Yeah,
stack?
It's called Banana, and it's a fork of Kibana itself.
Okay.
And also, I work for Lucidworks, so we build these dashboards too. There is an app studio, which builds on top of Solr or the Fusion product we have, and it's kind of like a competitor for Kibana or Banana as well.
Hi, Amrit here. So the term near real time. So for example, the earlier example that you gave, company ID, how it is performing based on clickstream data. So let's say I want the numbers up to last 5 minutes. So first question is, do we need to run that update expression every 5 minutes?
So you have to, I'm like, for the last 5 minutes, if you want to retrieve the information.
Until last 5 minutes.
Yes. So we will first provide the information about that you want only documents of last 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
You will execute that expression. We'll get your numbers.
Okay.
So you have to, you have to rerun your query every 5 minutes. Yes.
Oh, exactly. And the second question goes on the same example. We are looking for click to conversion until last 5 minutes from the beginning, right? So you are writing into probably some target collection.
Yes.
So while that collection is being updated, do I still have access to that probably old data versus new data? Because it's a simultaneous operation, right? Some rows might be updated, some might be having stale data. How do we handle that?
This is a concept called time series collection being introduced in recent versions. I'm not sure whether you're familiar with that or not. So time series collections now can host data depending on a particular regular intervals. So you really don't override the data. Obviously, you need to create your unique ID. I'm going into very details of Solr now, that how you can don't override your existing collection, right? So you need to, while forming those queries, so let me. Let's quickly go there. Right, so in this case, we have just campaign ID only. You can introduce a unique ID so that they don't get override in your respective final collection. So when I was building this talk, we introduced very complex queries, but then feedback came and we wanted to say dumb down this query so that everybody can understand. So those, when you're building this query, obviously in the division part here, right, the aggregated clicks can be zero. Right, something can be divided by zero is undefined. So you need to make sure that those checks are in place and you have a unique ID. Otherwise, check out time series collection in Solr, which will absolutely suffice your use case here.
Sure, thanks.
We have one question from the front.
Hey, so I just have one question. For unstructured data, like production logs, if you want to run analytics, Solr is fine. But you pointed out few other use cases, like stock market data,
yeah.
And which is kind of structured.
Yes.
So for that, Apache already has another project, Druid,
yeah.
Which is really good for real-time analytics. You can roll
right.
up, you can build dashboard and
right.
time series.
Right.
Yeah. So why prefer Solr over Druid?
Right. So
Druid.
I'll be really honest, this is an alternate. Right, it's an alternate of a solution. Talking about advantages of each, application of why Solr is better. He mentioned about Elasticsearch. We have to really get into the intrinsic features of each feature. Now, building analytics application here is fine, but again, that Apache project you mentioned, whether it can retrieve effective dynamic subsets from a large data set. Right. Right. It can fetch.
Yeah.
But this also, for structured data, you can look into that.
Yeah.
You can look into Solr, do performance benchmarking, and then you can do the comparison. But if you have unstructured data, then you have the Solr.
Yeah.
So yeah, answering your question, this is an alternate, not exactly, this is something which will rule over all other projects.
Yeah.
That would be the best answer for this.
For the unstructured, I totally agree. Solr will dominate every other
yeah.
product, but... Yeah,
for structured, you have other options too.
Yes.
Correct.